Good morning. We're good to have all you with us this morning as we, for the celebration of hope, as we then celebrate and sing and do all our alleluias with the band and the choir and everybody this morning. And then we will bury our alleluias and get ready for Lent. So good to have all of you with us this morning. Just a couple of announcements as we head to our week. Don't forget to pass the pew pads. We're excited for the Mardi Gras celebration this afternoon from 3 to 5, so come and join us and sample some food. And the kids will be making some masks with feathers and all kinds of fun stuff. Wendy's got that all under control, so fun afternoon, so we invite you to join us for that. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday already. We will do ashes and communion in the parking lot. The times are in the bulletin. I don't remember, it's early in the morning. And then 7:30 starts. And then worship at 6 o'clock with the choir and the handbells. And then the Wednesdays following in Lent, the dramas, the midweek Lent services. So if you can be a part of the dramas, let Pastor John know, and we'll be good for that. Mark your calendars, Beer and Hymns is coming up, and First Communion class is coming up, so mark those on your calendar as well. And then a prayer concern as we head into our week. We want to continue to keep Jeff Stelick in our prayers. As his health continues to decline, we want to keep him in our prayers. Jeff was moved from Madison to Tacoma this last week, so we will keep that family in our prayers as they walk with him on this journey. So we will keep them all in our prayers. As you are comfortable, would you please rise as we sing hymn number 815. Foreshadowed our adoption as your children. Make us heirs with Christ of your glory, and bring us to enjoy its fullness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from the 24th chapter of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a developing cloud, devouring fire on top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and for 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
And thanks be to God.
As you are comfortable, would you please rise for the gospel acclamation? According to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, Christ. You may be seated.
Shines as the morning star.
Well, before I begin the sermon proper, just a little bit of a plug here. For the Wednesday morning Bible study, we gather on Wednesday mornings from 9:30 to 11 over in the library. Spend the first half hour doing a little bit of gabbing, and then we get down to looking at the gospel reading for the coming week. The reason I lift that up to you is it really is a great time, and if you've got the opportunity, we invite you to join us. Each week is independent because we're looking at the gospel for the coming week. So if you miss a week or two, you don't get out of sync. And that's of significance this morning because while I show up at the Bible study as sort of the resident expert because I'm a pastor, the fact is we have a lot of good conversation and dialogue. And in fact, kind of some of the stuff that lies behind the sermon today is stuff that came out of that Bible study, and I didn't bring it. We came up with it as we conversed and chatted among ourselves. So it really is valuable, and that's kind of where the sermon angle goes this morning. So I have a question for you, or first a statement. It's February, mid-February, and one of the things that happens in our house in mid-February is I start getting really busy planning our summer vacation, because we like to take a little vacation trip. And so I've been thinking about a vacation trip. Maybe ever take a vacation trip, go someplace, Florida, California, Texas, New York, someplace, right? You all kind of have done those kinds of things in the past. So I have a question, sort of a quiz question, and I will warn you right off, it is a bit of a there's a bit of a trick to it. And the question is, if you've gone on a trip, there's one thing that I guarantee, absolutely, that you did on that trip. What do you think it is?
Slept.
Maybe. Maybe you took a trip to the Dells for the day and didn't take a nap on the way back.
Yeah,
that's good.
Took pictures, ate things.
Probably. That's good. Maybe. I can't guarantee it, but that's good.
Breathe.
Yeah. Okay. You breathe. I don't know. I brought this up here at Salem Terrace the other day, and one person said, spent too much money, and another person said, forgot something. You know, you always forget something. Here's the one thing I guarantee you did if you went on a trip. You came back. I mean, think about that. We went to Colorado last summer, and so someone said, what'd you do on your vacation last year? Well, we went to Colorado. We did come back. But we went to Colorado. We never say we came back. We always talk about the going and not the returning. You know, in a sense, that dynamic is a part of the gospel reading this morning. The story of the transfiguration recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We hear Matthew's version this morning. And we hear this awesome story, in some ways, sort of a story beyond our imagination in some levels. Because we have Jesus taking with him Peter, James, and John, and they go up the mountain. They go on their trip, and they go up the mountain, because the mountaintop is where holy, sacred, fabulous things take place. And while they're on the mountain, the text tells us Jesus was transfigured. He was transfigured, and what does that mean? Well, he started to glow like the sun. Now, other than the kids in the building here today, most of you are parents. What do you tell your child about the sun? Don't look at the sun. You know, don't stare at the sun, right? You know, you don't do that because the sun is way too bright. Jesus was bright like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. This is an awesome moment. And in theological terms, theologians would call this a theophany, an appearance of God. It is a theophany, and it is this awesome moment. And then Moses and Elijah appear. Moses, who was the greatest prophet of the Old Testament, the giver of the law, and Elijah was the one person in the Old Testament who didn't die. He was taken up into heaven in a chariot, and Jewish tradition held, and it's recorded in the very end. Go to the Old Testament, go home to your Old Testament, your Bible, open up to the Old Testament, go to the very last two verses of the Old Testament, and there it is. Elijah will return. Elijah was understood to be the precursor for the Messiah. And so we have Jesus standing there glowing like the sun, clothes dazzling white, with Moses on one side and Elijah on the other. Hey folks, it doesn't get any better than this. Well, spoiler alert, it does. But for the moment, it doesn't get any better than this. This is an incredible moment. And then it gets even more incredible. A cloud overshadows them, and a voice from the cloud proclaims, "This is my son with whom I am pleased. Listen to him." And the disciples fall down in fear. Now, when they open their eyes, Moses and Elijah are gone. Jesus is back to normal. But also, Jesus comes to them. The text is very deliberate. He comes to them, and he touches them, and he says, "Do not be afraid." Now, I know most of that story is beyond our imagination, although I don't stare at the sun too often. I haven't seen people glow like the sun, and I haven't run into Moses and Elijah lately. I have not experienced this awesome, incredible theophany moment. It's kind of out of my realm. But one thing that is in my realm is fear. Because I feel fear. We feel fear throughout our lives. I mean, think about the four-year-old who's afraid of the thunder. I mean, you and I may say, "Oh, big deal, it's just thunder, you know." But to a four-year-old, it's almost an existential threat. And the 14-year-old who wakes up one morning and says, "Oh, I didn't do my paper. I didn't do my report for school." Or the 14-year-old who says, "My friends don't want to hang around with me anymore." The 24-year-old blushing bride at the back of the aisle, ready to walk down the aisle, thinking, "Oh my gosh, am I ready for this?" Or maybe even worse, the groom standing up front thinking the same thing. "Am I ready for this?" Or the 34-year-old with an infant, a young infant, saying, "Where's the instruction manual? What do I do?" Or the 44-year-old who's got that 14-year-old who's a little late coming home and they're wondering, is there something wrong? Or the 54-year-old trying to figure out how they're going to handle juggling all the expenses of college and everything else for their kids and paying the bills. Or the 64-year-old looking up and realizing, it's almost retirement. Now what? We walk through fear in our journey of life time and time again. We journey in the midst of a world that is filled with fear, but also filled with brokenness and hurt and pain and uncertainty, vulnerability, and lots of sin. We walk through that journey. And that's part of our daily rhythm of life. What we would like to do is we would like to climb the mountain where Jesus theophanies in front of us, and we'd like to camp ourselves out and stay there. And Peter has that idea. Peter has that notion. In the text, Peter says, "Lord, let's make three dwellings. We can hang out here for a whole long time." But we can't, because that's not where we are. We are down off the mountain. And so the mountaintop experience comes to an end. But what doesn't come to an end is the presence of Jesus. Because Jesus, like that trip to Colorado that we took last year, doesn't just then hang out in Colorado. Jesus returns. Jesus comes down from the mountain to walk with us. To walk with us in the journey of life and in the storyline of Matthew, to walk through the rest of the gospel until Jesus ends up on another mountaintop, which we call Calvary, where he hangs on the cross. And that is why we call this day Celebration of Hope. Because hope is not about something I have. Hope is about something I see, that I hope for, that I literally hope for, but that I don't necessarily have. And so we gather this day in a celebration of hope, and we sort of figuratively climb that mountain so that we can witness the theophany of Jesus. We can witness the glory and the wonder. But then we're going to come back down, and we're going to go on to another mountain called Calvary. And then we're going to discover that while the theophany of transfiguration is incredibly wonderful, It does get better than that. Because on the hill called Calvary, Jesus doesn't just shine like the sun, which is a great thing. Jesus gives his life for us, which is an even greater thing. And then, a couple days later, the resurrected Jesus encounters us on Easter morning and restores life, life in its fullest. But in the meantime, Jesus walks with us. The Jesus who came to Peter, James, and John, who came to them, touched them, and said, "Do not be afraid," also comes to us, reaches out to us, and says, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid, because I am with you." And that Jesus walks with us, holds us in his grace, empowers us to be faithful disciples, and sends us forth to a world that is filled with fear and brokenness and vulnerability and all those other things in order to bring to the world the message of hope. The message of hope that we celebrate this day. That we're not just going to stay on this mountain for a little bit, and that we're not going to stay on the mountain just to watch Jesus glow. The glowing Jesus will become the crucified and risen Jesus. And so what we get today is sort of a little bit of a foretaste of what God is up to, and a reminder that the one who walks with us is the one who makes the difference between life and death. The one who walks with us is the one who will bring us hope, the fullness of life, and give us the answer to our hopes and our dreams. That there is something more than what we see around us in a broken world. That God is at work. And so we celebrate this day. We celebrate that hope. And then we look ahead and we see that we're going to go off the mountain and walk through the valley. But there is that other hill. That other hill that we're aiming towards. The hill with three crosses and an empty tomb just behind it. The journey of faithful discipleship. The journey that is empowered by God's presence in Jesus, and the journey we celebrate this day as we celebrate the hope that we have, even in the midst of a very tattered, broken, and hurting world. And that's why we sing, "Shine, Jesus, shine." There's your cue. "Shine, Jesus, shine," because Jesus is shining in our midst. And that Jesus will walk with us as we journey as faithful disciples, as we journey as people of God. We continue with singing, "Shine, Jesus, shine," hymn number 671. As you are comfortable, could you please rise?
Thank you.
Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
Enroll your church as it witnesses to the majesty and mercy of your Son. Equip lay preachers, deacons, and pastors. Move us to share our stories of your faithfulness and forgiveness. May our lives proclaim your greatness. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Dwell with your whole creation, from the tallest mountain peak to the deepest valley. Bless the work of conservation, organizations, and protect vital habitats. Support the work of disaster relief agencies around the world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Guide and give wisdom to all in authority, our mayor and local leaders, our governor and state legislators, our president and national legislators. Bring freedom and justice to all nations. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Give shelter to those lacking safe homes. Spur communities to work for fair housing for all. Protect our neighbors whose dwellings do not keep out dangerous cold or heat. Accompany with your touch those who are homebound, sick, or isolated. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Make us eager to receive your word in Scripture. Help us recognize Jesus' voice in the needs of our neighbors. Make us confident to follow the way of the cross. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Guide us with love and watch over your servants to be faithful disciples of Jesus. Be with our confirmation students, especially Deanna and Jackson, as they seek to grow in their discipleship, and guide their families that together then we reflect your love and grace. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Walk with those who seek your presence. Be especially with Jeff during these days of uncertainty. Grant him strength to face each day and fill him with your peace and hope. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive our thanksgiving for the holy ones who have guided us in faithfulness and gathered even the unlikely as your people. With our forebears in faith and all who have hoped in you, teach us to wait with courage until the promised day dawns. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.
You may be seated. It is a hungry jar moment, so if we have kids who want to bring things up, hungry jar. Right here, yep, so it should be right over here. Again, the recipient this month is Sleep in Heavenly Peace. And for those of you who are older kids, you're welcome to come up as well. Or you can sneak up after worship, or you can flag down one of the kids and say, hey, run this up for me, and they'll be happy to do that. Sleep in Heavenly Peace is a wonderful ministry, program ministry in our community. So thank you for your support of them. I see another, yeah, there's one, good. So as they're doing that, I know I'm going to be joined by the choir in a moment. Don't get waked out by that. They have music to share. But I want to talk to you a little bit about one of the ministries that we support, and that is Lutheran Social Services. Beginning with an orphanage in Wittenberg in 1882, Lutheran Social Services of Wisconsin and Upper Michigan has worked to meet the needs of people. Today, LSS carries out ministries in adoption, foster parenting, refugee services, mental health, disabilities, youth and family needs, senior services, homelessness, and addictions. And these services are offered regardless of race or creed. And in fact, Pastor Jean and I adopted Rebecca through LSS. To meet the needs of a changing world, LSS operates group homes, counseling facilities, and outreach programs. It invites those whose lives are in disarray to begin the work of rebuilding their lives, not with a handout, but with a helping hand to lift them up. LSS is part of a larger network of Lutheran social service agencies, many of which use LSS in their name. LSSI, for example, is the LSS in Illinois. While our LSS is independent, it works with other agencies to form the largest network of social service agencies in the United States. As Lutherans, we make a huge difference in the lives of ordinary people. And many of those ordinary people are people who would be easily overlooked and forgotten. Yet we remember that Jesus calls us to reach out to even the least of these. Support for LSS in the past year included support through the Norwegian dinner proceeds and also the Mission Endowment Fund disbursement that was approved at the annual meeting a few weeks ago included money support for LSS. That support, combined with resources from other congregations, allows LSS to make a difference in many lives around the state. If you want more information about LSS, you can go to their website. It's pretty simple. LSS WIS for Wisconsin. LSSWIS.org. So thank you for your support in these ways, the dinner, the endowment fund, ways in which we've been able to support the ministry of LSS. And thank you for all of your support for all of the work that we do together.
Every day, every hour, he is with me.
As you're comfortable, would you please rise as we continue with the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Please join me in the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come and taste the joy of God. Please note as we partake in communion, we have grape juice in addition to the wine and gluten-free wafers in addition to the regular wafers. If you have needed that when you come forward, please let us know and we will gladly share that with you. Come, for all is ready. Please be seated.
Thank you.
children's message. So let us pray.
Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth abundantly from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you.
Amen.
At this time, I would invite the children to come forward, and please bring your alleluia.
Come on up here, have a seat, have a seat. I still like your alleluia because it does look like a watermelon. That was a really good alleluia. So I have a question for you. What does alleluia mean? I mean, we got this word, So you got this word alleluia. What in the world is alleluia, do you know? So here's how I was thinking about it. You know, we're almost going into Lent, right? And Lent is in March, and March is also basketball, March Madness season. If you like basketball, they're playing basketball, lots of basketball games are being played, and lots of tournaments. And what if we had a basketball team, okay? And we have a team, and maybe we have Maya and Pastor Gene on our team, too. I gotta tell you, Pastor Gene's not very good at basketball. I'm just saying, you know, I mean, and let's imagine we're playing a game and she's out on the court, because we gotta play everybody at least sometime. And it's down to the final end of the game, and we're down by a point, and all of a sudden the ball gets loose, and there are only seconds left, and Pastor Gene grabs the ball, and she puts up the shot, and she scores, and what do we say?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah! That's pretty good, yeah. What? Yeah. Ready? Yes! Weston. Yes! Linda, yes! That's what we won the game! Wow, I can't believe you made the shot! We won the game! That's kind of what alleluia is. Because you know what we're gonna do in a few weeks? When we go to Good Friday, we're gonna see someone named Jesus die on the cross. And we're gonna think, well, that's kind of a bummer. But then on Easter morning, we're going to discover Jesus rose from the dead, and we're going to say, where's my cue over here? Then we're going to say,
hallelujah!
Okay, right? Okay, ready? Yeah, he got it. Ready? We're going to say, you want to rescue? One, two, three.
Hallelujah!
That was bad. Let's try this again. One, two, three.
Hallelujah!
That was better. Much better. Yeah, we're going to say, hallelujah. And that's why we use this word, because it's a special word that allows us to share our praise of God, right? But the problem is, we're going into Lent. And during Lent, it's just not quite the right feel. And so what we do, because we want to be thinking about what Jesus did on the cross first, because he died on the cross, that's kind of sad, right? We're going to take the alleluias and we're going to bury them. We're going to bury them in a box. And we're not going to use that word until we get to Easter, when we are going to say, one, two, three.
Hallelujah!
Pretty cool, isn't it? So what we're going to do is we are going to sing our last alleluias for the time. And we're going to, you guys can join Pastor Jean, because she got the winning shot. She gets to do the score. She gets to do this. And you guys are going to kind of walk around the church. And here's what I want you to take your alleluias and watch you walk around. Don't walk around like this. I want you to walk around going, alleluia, because we're doing our alleluias. And while you're doing that, Maya and I are going to take down the alleluia banners. And then we're going to put them all into the box. And they're going to stay there until we get to Easter, when we can say, one, two, three.
Hallelujah!
You're getting better. You're getting better. That's good. That's good. Okay? So, what's that? I think the drumming's pretty cool. Yeah. Good job. Good job. So, we're going to sing alleluia. I think I'll ask you to remain. It's in the bulletin. It's in the bulletin. And you may remain seated. I think seated. Yes, right? Yeah, main seated. That way you can watch the kids going around with their alleluias. And then when you guys come back up here, we're going to stay up here for the end of the service. So we're going to go dancing. Okay? A little dancing today. You ready for that? All right. So, band. One, two, three. Hit it.
Oh,
justice and breaks the oppressor's rod. Bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen. The closing hymn is number 866, but there's a catch. Can I catch your catch? Go for it.
I'll catch. So okay. The catch is, I would much rather on this hymn leave dancing than just singing. I may love to sing, but let's dance a little bit too. So what we're going to do is we're going to march, the first verse marching, and then on the bottom, you'll notice there are other verses. We are going to pray second, sing third, and dance a little bit on the last verse. And I invite you to not be so Northern European like I am, and do a little wiggle at least, or a little wave, or do a little dancing, and dance, because this is our celebration of hope. As you're comfortable, would you please rise? We continue with hymn number 866. We march, we pray, we sing, and we dance. You guys can ready to dance. We're going to march around the church too. Ready? Yeah.